Looks like it's going to be a very intimate setting here. I don't know if you want to come down and sit a bit closer to the front. We can keep it fairly low key. Keep talking. Oh, we'll make a start. So my name's Jeremy Smith, and I'm one of the academics at Human Sciences. And so I'm basically a neuroscientist. So I'm interested in how the brain control things. And so what I'm going to talk to you about today is basically how the brain controls our appetite. Why is it that, you know, the title of my presentation here is why is my brain telling me that I'm hungry? And obviously, for a lot of people, with a lot of different people, this signal from our brain can be quite strong. And, you know, I'm going to talk to you about obesity and how it's a big problem. But I'm also going to talk to you about what happens to your brain and in your brain when you are hungry. Okay, some of the bad things basically that happens to your brain. So just as a quick overview, these are the four main things that I want to talk to you about. We're going to talk a little bit about neuroscience and determine what actually in our brain signals to us that we are hungry. What actually happens if we are hungry, and both this is in a, both an acute state, you know, I don't know if you guys have skipped lunch or what you've done, so you may be hungry right now, or what happens in a relatively more prolonged state if you go through an extended period of undernutrition. Then I want to talk to you about these guys here. So the bulk of my research is involved in understanding these neurons here. These are called kisspeptin neurons. They've got a cool little name, which I'll talk to you a little bit about. And the potential role that they play both in response to being hungry, but also a novel thing that they may do, and that they may also signal messages about appetite as well. And then we're also going to talk to you a little bit about obesity and the problem that we're faced with. It's a relatively modern problem, I guess, this increasing prevalence of obesity. Okay, so I mentioned that I'm a neuroscientist, and so the sort of the field that we're going to be talking about here is a field of neuroendocrinology, okay? So this is essentially neuro, meaning the brain, and endocrine, which is governed, sort of a word that encapsulates sort of our hormones. And so this sort of field that I'm in is how hormones and the brain interact, and specifically for what we're going to talk to, what I'm talking to you about today, is how this balance here controls energy balance. And so energy balance is just food intake versus energy expenditure, okay? Now, within our brain, there's a specialized part, if you like, of the brain that's critically involved in both, or pretty much all our neuroendocrine mechanisms, but really, it's really key for this control of energy balance. And it's the part of the brain called the hypothalamus, okay? And it's just this little green dot here. And so neuroendocrinologists like myself firmly believe that within this brain here, all this stuff here, this cortex and cerebellum here, is all just sort of positioned in a spot so it can protect this hypothalamus, just the most important part of the brain, at least is what, that's what we feel. Okay, so what determines food intake? Now, there's a number of little things on this slide, so you don't have to worry about most of them. I just want to try and take you through some of the key things that regulate food intake. And essentially what they are these hormonal systems within this neuroendocrinology field. And these hormonal systems basically boil down to outside signals, signals from outside of our brain that get into our brain to tell us that we're hungry. An initial one that's been known for a long time is that there are neural signals coming directly from your gastrointestinal tract, okay? These are signals that can pretty much just relay when your stomach is empty, okay? If your stomach's empty, you can kind of feel that. It doesn't feel nice and you want to get some food and put it in there. There are also nutrient signals. And so these are basically key elements of the food that we're eating that the brain can also sense, okay? So we've got fatty acids from our fats that we eat, glucose from our carbohydrates, and amino acids from the proteins that we eat that circulate within our blood, and our brain and our hypothalamus has receptors that can detect the levels of these things. Okay, and so obviously when they're low, it signals to the brain, come on, let's start eating, let's get some food in here. Like I mentioned, the main thing that I'm interested in are the hormones, okay? And so is various hormones that are inhibitors of food intake or inhibitors of appetite. The main one of these is leptin, and I'm going to talk to you a lot about leptin and not so much about insulin, but insulin is another hormone. It's from the pancreas. It's involved in the regulation of blood sugar. It also signals to the brain when insulin levels are high, it tells your brain that you've got enough food. You probably don't need to be eating, and that's what leptin does as well. Then we have our stimulators, and there's this hormone here called ghrelin. It comes from your stomach. It's secreted from your stomach when it is empty, okay? And it tells your brain, come on, let's get some food. We're really hungry here. And also glucagon, which is another hormone from the pancreas. It works in concert, I guess, with insulin to control these blood sugar levels. If you eat a big meal, you secrete insulin, okay? So it kind of makes sense. It tells you to stop eating. If you are fasting, glucagon levels increase, and it's to liberate sugar from your stored glycogen stores within your muscle. And so if glucagon is present in the bloodstream, it's going to tell your brain, come on, let's get some food. Body temperature is an interesting one. It's relatively poorly studied, but it's known if you're in a cold environment, you tend to feel hungry a bit more. Okay, I don't know if you're aware of this during winter, potentially. You start to, you know, you're craving those Sunday roasts every day of the week kind of thing. And it's potentially due to the fact that when you eat food, your temperature, your internal temperature rises a little bit. Okay, this is known as the thermal effect of food. And so potentially when you're in a cold environment, your appetite tends to increase a little bit more. And then there are an abundance of psychological factors that affect our food intake. Okay, stress is a big one, and it's a really weird one because it affects different people in different ways. So you may be aware of, if you're really stressed, you might not really feel like eating, but then potentially other people who, in their stress, they just want to, you know, get the chocolate and the donuts and, you know, stuff like that. Makes you feel good. And we'll talk about that as well as we go along. So these are the factors, and what I really want to focus on are these hormones here. And so what they do, or where they're from, is sort of indicated in this diagram here. So we've got fat. So this is a little schematic here indicating our fat stores. They produce leptin, okay? So your fat is an endocrine hormone. It's producing hormone, all right? I'm going to focus a little bit more on leptin. As I said, pancreas produces insulin. It also produces glucagon. Stomach produces ghrelin. Then you've got this whole bunch of other things here coming from the gastrointestinal tract, cholecystic kinase, glucagon-like peptide. There's a huge amount. This is just a small sort of snapshot of various chemicals and messengers and things like that, which are thought to provide signals, if you like, to the hypothalamus to regulate how hungry you feel. Okay. Now, drug companies are really interested in all these things because, as I've mentioned to you, obesity is becoming a very big problem. And so they're utilising, or potentially utilising, these sorts of things to maybe interrogate their potential, if you like, for future therapeutics in regard to potentially looking at treatments for obesity. Okay, I want to focus on leptin. It's one of the most classical effectors of food intake. It, as I mentioned, it's produced from fat and it's referred to as a satiety hormone. Okay, so it's a hormone that tells you to stop eating, all right? Now, there's two mice here and they're a little bit different, okay? One of these mice does not have leptin, okay? Can anyone have a guess which mice has not got the leptin? The big one, yep. So these mice, it's a natural mutation in these mice. It was discovered way back in the 60s. And these mice basically have a mutation in the gene that makes leptin, okay? So there's no leptin coming from their fat. There's no signal to their brain to tell them to stop eating. So they have just got a ravenous appetite, okay? They basically look like little round tennis balls. They are just humongous. They just love their food. and they just can't stop eating because their brain is not sensing any leptin, so their brain thinks that they are starving. They're under a condition of perceived starvation. They think that they're extremely hungry. So it's a really interesting thing, and these mice have been studied enormously, and the effects of leptin has been studied in these mice as well. And it's not only mice, humans, or sorry, next slide. But these mice, if you give them leptin, the obesity is essentially corrected for. And these are, again, these studies that were done back in the 60s that discovered the leptin. And if you took one of these leptin-deficient mice here and then a normal mouse here, and you can transfuse serum from this mouse into this mouse, this is studies done in the 60s, that mouse returns to its normal weight. Okay, so they knew back then that there was something missing in this mouse, and it was subsequently discovered that that signal was leptin, okay, the hormone produced from fat. Humans also have examples of mutations in leptin, and so this is what we can see here. So this poor little guy here, he's only 3 years of age, and he weighs 42 kilograms, okay? He has a mutation in leptin. He doesn't make leptin, so his brain is under this condition of perceived starvation, okay? Huge appetite. And you can see here, this is the same individual after the mutation was discovered, and this little guy was then treated with leptin. And you can see, 4 years later, and he's 10 kilos lighter, despite growing, a fair bit of height. So leptin is really key, okay? It's really important for all of us in regulating our satiety. And the way it works is that the hypothalamus basically has a stimulation of appetite. It tells us to eat, okay? So we eat a lot of food, okay? In this case, you know, a mouthful of French fries. Obviously, then that food then leads to the accumulation of our fat, okay, in our fat cells. Our fat cells are producing the leptin, and that leptin, in a perfect world, will signal back to our brain to tell us to stop eating. Okay, if you've got enough leptin, it's going to tell your brain you should probably stop eating. You don't need to, you know, keep filling up these fat cells with lipid. Obviously, then food intake starts to decrease, the fat cells become smaller, and you've got less leptin, and so that inhibition of appetite actually is removed. Then you start eating more food again. Okay, so it's this constant cycle, if you like, within an individual of leptin. And it's a nice little cycle because it regulates food intake and our level of adiposity to a set point. Okay. Now, as I've mentioned, all these things signal to the hypothalamus. All right. Now, it's getting very technical here, but you don't really need to know any of this stuff because you're not going to be examined or anything like that. But there are key parts of the hypothalamus called hypothalamic nuclei where the leptin is actually sending its message to. Okay. Now, they've all got these really unimaginative names, the ventromedial hypothalamic nucleus, the lateral hypothalamus, dorsal medial hypothalamic nucleus, the paraventricular nucleus. A really good one is the arcuate nucleus, and we'll get into that in a second. But we've known for a long time that different parts of the hypothalamus signal for different things and for different mechanisms. Okay? And this was basically known since the 40s and the 50s, and we've known that the hypothalamus is really important for governing food intake for at least 100 years, and that's because injuries to the hypothalamus almost always cause obesity. Okay, so the hypothalamus will control for food intake and the predisposition to become obese. What we can see, and this is some very, very early studies, and what they showed was that key areas of the hypothalamus, as I mentioned, have key functional significance, if you like. And so if you look at the VMH, the ventral medial hypothalamus, if there's injuries to this part of the hypothalamus, or utilizing animal models, you can lesion different parts of the hypothalamus here. If you do that, this area here causes obesity. Okay, so it's thought that there is a satiety center within the hypothalamus there, an area that receives a leptin basically, and then tells higher centers of the brain you need to stop eating. On the flip side, out here in the lateral hypothalamus, if there's damage to this part of the hypothalamus here, it causes starvation and the reduction of food intake. And so what we've got here is a center of the hypothalamus that actively tells your higher centers of your brain and your cortex, you need to go get some food, okay? And so leptin can signal to all these regions here to basically regulate their activity, with the final endpoint being, you know, whether or not you go and eat that McDonald's or eat that donut or whatever it is you choose to eat. Now, I mentioned the arcuate nucleus, and the reason for that is because a lot of the studies now have narrowed down from these areas here the arcuate nucleus to be the most critical area for regulating food intake, okay? Now, on this diagram here, the arcuate nucleus is just located on either side of this little ventricle here, which is the third ventricle. And it's right at the base of the brain and the base of the hypothalamus, and it's in a perfect position because it can receive all these signals coming from the blood, okay? Leptin being the key signal. It can receive these leptin signals and basically act accordingly. So if we look at the arcuate nucleus, we can see it contains two main neuron types, these blue guys and these orange guys, okay? The blue guys here are neurons that express neuropeptides MPY and AGRP, all right? These are the bad guys. These guys tell other areas of the hypothalamus, like those ones I showed you before, to eat food, okay? They want you to eat as much food as you possibly can. When these guys are firing, you're hungry. Or when you're hungry, these guys are firing, okay? On the flip side, you've got these orange guys, these POMC neurons, okay? They do the opposite thing. When they're firing, it's suppressing food intake. It's telling you, you know, perhaps it's not a good idea to eat. You've got plenty of food inboard, you know, you don't need to be eating more food. This is a very, very busy slide, and I don't really want you to worry about it too much, but basically all it's showing you here is the activity of AGRP neurons, okay? And this is pretty much what happens in your brain when you are hungry, okay? These MPY AGRP neurons are firing like crazy, okay? Now this sort of data that you can see here is just taking you through an example. This is a mouse-based study in which these MPY AGRP neurons are able to be genetically targeted, and what they actually will do is if you shine a fluorescent or a blue wave light onto these neurons, you can get them to fire, okay? And so this is just showing you schematically, looking at this little fiber optic cable pointing at the arcuate nucleus, and you can see here this is just the little sort of schematic showing you the stimulation protocol here. So where you see this little blue shading here, this is the blue wave light shined on these neurons here. And what you can see, this is, as I mentioned, a mouse-based study, so they're eating pellets of food. When you turn the lights on and stimulate those MPY neurons, the animals just become ravenous, all right? They eat an enormous amount of food. Okay, you can see that here, and you can also see it here. So this is a bar graph here showing the mean response of these animals in terms of their food intake. When you turn the lights on, you stimulate the AGRP or the MPY AGRP neurons, these animals will just eat an enormous amount of food. Okay, so when you are hungry, these neurons are firing like crazy and they are telling you to eat, okay? They also do a number of other things, okay? They signal to your brain when you are hungry and they cause a little thing that happens to you when you get hungry. And it's, I guess, known now as hangry, and it's a real thing now, okay? We all experience it. I'm sure we all experience it. If you've got children, I don't know if any either of you have got children, but I've got a two-year-old, and his emotional output before dinner versus 10 minutes after he started eating is enormous, okay? So hangry, this is what happens to your brain when you're hungry, acutely hungry. You can get aggressive, you get very upset, and it's purely because you are hungry. And it's a real thing now, oops, and it's known that this hangry is known to be stimulated via those neuropeptide neurons, okay? This is an article written in The Conversation here a little while ago. I think it's just a few months old now. So It shows or details that when you are hungry and those AGRP-NP Y neurons, this is neuropeptide Y, and it's a neuropeptide Y-mediated mechanism, that this neuropeptide Y, in addition to signaling to other brain areas to tell you to eat, it actually signals to parts of your brain known as the limbic system that governs emotion and things like that, and it will make you angry, okay? And I guess it kind of makes sense if you think about it. If you're hungry, if back in sort of, when we were hunter-gatherers, if you were hungry, you probably needed to try and catch some food. So maybe it makes a little bit of sense to drive a little bit of anger or something like that. And it really is a strong emotional trigger, if you like, to try and go out and basically remedy the fact that you are actually hungry. So hangry, yes, it is actually a real thing. So there's examples of what happens during acute hunger. Okay, what happens when hunger is more prolonged? Okay, and so what we're talking about here is essentially undernutrition. Okay, so this could be days, weeks, months of when there is inadequate nutrition to cope with, you know, normal energy expenditure. And you can see here, this is by no means an exhaustive list here. This is just some of the things that I thought of. You can have retarded growth, reduced mental performance. Glucose is a really important fuel source for our brains. And so if glucose levels start to decline, we have reduced mental performance. Immune deficiencies. One of the big ones that I'm interested in, and I'm going to talk to you in a couple slides time about, is infertility results during undernutrition. And also a really big one now is that if you go through a period of undernutrition and it's restored, you can have obesity in later life. And this is a really interesting aspect of undernutrition in terms of transitional societies or developing countries that are now starting to increase sort of the socioeconomic status of the population is starting to increase, and so obviously with that they're starting to get greater and greater access to food. They are showing very high incidences of obesity. In addition to that, if undernutrition is present during pregnancy, okay, there's a number of researchers at UWA looking at this as well. If there's undernutrition during pregnancy in offspring, the chances of the offspring becoming obese in later life increases dramatically. So it's a number of things that are being studied in terms of what happens during an undernutritional state. So I want to talk about infertility a little bit here. And so what this little statue here is the Woman of Willendorf. So it's a statue, it's about 25,000 years old. I believe it's one of the most earliest artwork that humans have ever produced, okay? And you can see here it's obviously a female figure. It's relatively plump, okay? And it also has quite obvious signs of female reproduction. So it has obvious breasts and an enlarged vagina, okay? Now, it's thought of that this little statue here was thought to indicate that in times in which nutrition was plentiful, reproductive success was higher, okay? So it's thought that, or at least scientists like me believe that this is the first indication that there is a link between nutrition and fertility, okay? And we know that really well now, and so in cases of undernutrition, and this is prevalent even today and even in Western societies, in dancers and gymnasts and things like that and marathon runners. If there is a state of relative undernutrition and fat stores are really low, infertility results, okay? In addition to that, with this increasing level of adiposity, and I understand that this person here looks relatively like this person here, but in cases of obesity now, we are also seeing changes in fertility and aspects of infertility resulting from overnutrition as well. But I just want to focus a little bit on undernutrition. Now, how nutrition regulates fertility, it appears that leptin may be key. Okay, so this is that hormone leptin that I talked to you about. And again, what we've got here, this is the Obi mouse. So this is that mouse that lacks leptin. Okay, remembering this guy here is under a condition of perceived starvation. Okay, even though he's got lots of fat on board here, the brain still thinks that this animal is starving. Okay, and you can see here, these are neurons within the hypothalamus. Okay. Now, in the normal state, these neurons are firing. In the Obi state, they seem to be a little bit quieter. They're not firing as much. But when you give back the Obi animal its leptin, they start to fire again. Okay? Now, this is important because the neurons that we're looking at here are neurons expressing a neuropeptide called kisspeptin, or kisspeptin neurons. Okay? Now, kisspeptin neurons are critical for reproduction, okay? It was discovered almost 10 years ago now, or a little bit longer than 10 years ago, actually, that in humans, if you have a mutation in this little receptor here called GPR54, infertility results. So if you have an absence of this receptor, you don't go through puberty, and you have this sort of long word here, hypergonadotropic hypergonadism. It basically means you're infertile, okay? So it's known now that kisspeptin neurons, or kisspeptin, is critical for driving fertility, okay? And it does so by activating this specific receptor here called GPR54. Now, just as a side note, you've got a neuropeptide here called kisspeptin, really critical for reproduction. The name KISS actually didn't come about due to this sort of kissing, reproduction, fertility type link. I don't know how old you guys are, but unfortunately it's not due to this link here either. It was actually due because the lab groups here that were studying this molecule here were from Hershey, Pennsylvania, okay? And they wanted to name their discovery after something really synonymous to their region. And so they thought, what's the most famous thing about Hershey, Pennsylvania? Well, it's the Hershey chocolate. And so they named this gene after chocolate, after the Hershey chocolate kisses. And it's just been serendipitous that this gene that they discovered and called KISS is critical for reproduction. Okay, so you can see here, this is a paper published in 2012 showing that kisspeptin is critical for switching on puberty. If you don't believe scientific journals, that's fine. You can believe Disney. I don't know if either of you have seen this movie here, Big Hero 6, but in a critical scene within this movie here, he diagnoses puberty in his young friend here, and it's probably impossible for you guys to read here, but what it says just in that little portion of the screen here, GPR54 detected. Okay, so we thought, you know, we're science nerds, we thought this is fantastic, you know. An aspect of our work here is being recognised by Disney in a feature film. All right, in the few minutes that I've got left, I just want to quickly talk to you about obesity, okay? It's a big problem and it's getting worse, but what is obesity, okay? It's essentially just having a very high amount of body fat in relation to your body mass, okay, or your lean body mass. And so one of the key measures, if you like, of whether or not a person is obese is this body mass index here, this BMI score. And it's essentially just a weight divided by height measure. It's not a great measure because it doesn't really take into consideration muscle mass and other lean body mass, but it's a quick and easy method of determining someone's, obviously, weight divided by their height. And so it's, by definition, if a person has a BMI over 25 kilograms per meter square, they're classed as overweight. If their BMI is above 30, then they're classed as obese. Okay. If we look at the prevalence of obesity at the global level, as I mentioned, it's a big problem and it's getting worse. Okay. There's a lot of lines on this slide here, so you don't really need to worry too much about what it's actually showing, but you can see as a general rule, this is obesity in adults according to year, and you can see here, coming in through the mid-90s into 2015 here, we're seeing steady increases in obesity, okay? So much so that in Australia, 2/3 of adults are either overweight or obese. Okay, so 2/3, okay, more than half of us are either overweight or obese. Okay, so it's a huge problem, and it's obviously a big problem in Western societies. But as you can see here in this graph here, we've got examples of populations with a low socio-demographic index. So developing countries where there's relatively low socioeconomic status. And you can see even in those developing countries here, there is an increase in prevalence in obesity here. Okay. The dashed lines here are females versus males. So you can see in all populations here that the prevalence of obesity is higher in females than it is in males. And what is really alarming is that the prevalence of obesity in children is increasing as well. Okay? So it's a very big problem. Okay? Why is it a problem? Well, the problem is that this leptin hormone and the way it works that I showed you a few minutes ago, it doesn't work very well. Okay? We seem to be predisposed to just ignore our leptin and just keep eating our food. Okay? And one of the key things that can actually happen to the majority of the population when they start to get obese is that we become resistant to leptin. Okay? Similar to type 2 diabetes, where you see a resistance to insulin, obesity seems to result in the majority of the population due to a resistance to this hormone leptin. It just doesn't work very well anymore. Okay? So we're trying to work out why. And so part of the reason why leptin doesn't seem to work very well comes back to these AGRP and POMC neurons. Okay? A key characteristic of our POMC neurons, so remember these are the neurons that are telling us not to stop eating, okay, is that they produce a lot of free radicals, a lot more free radicals than these AGRP neurons produce. They're the ones that are telling us to eat. Okay? For this reason, it appears very likely that these POMC neurons are susceptible to degeneration, particularly as we age. Okay? So as we get older, we seem to see a preferential loss of our POMC neurons over our AGRP neurons. So we're pretty much faced with this situation as we get older. We start to see less POMC neurons in comparison to our NPY AGRP neurons. So the signal to keep eating our food is still there, but the signal to stop eating our food appears to be lost, and this occurs as we age. And so this is thought to be one of the key reasons why we see this increase or adult onset of obesity. Okay, these key differences between these bad guys here telling us to eat donuts and things like that, and the good guys here telling us to, you know, you don't need to eat. You've got plenty of nutritional stores on board. Let's just take it easy. In addition to that, these AGRP and PY neurons, these bad guys here, they also are able to send out this little red arm here that actively inhibits these guys here. So they're kind of like a bully, all right? They'll signal to your brain to keep eating, but they'll also signal to these guys here and tell them basically to shut up, all right? We don't want you signaling. We want to tell an individual to keep eating, okay? So this ensures a very, very strong drive in all of us for food intake. Okay, the drive for stimulating food intake in just about every person is stronger than the drive for us to tell us, you know, don't eat. And you can sort of see that, you know, in almost every individual, I guess. If you've eaten a big meal and someone, you know, tempts you with a lovely dessert, you probably don't feel that hungry, but something in your mind says, you know, I think it's a good idea, I might eat this, it's going to make me feel good. That's these guys, okay? They're stomping all over these guys. They're signaling to your brain areas, yeah, you want to eat that food. It's going to make you feel good. All right, and just like probably 2 minutes, I just really want to tell you a little bit more about our KISS peptide neurons here and the potential that they have to actually regulate energy balance, okay? The reason we know this is that there is a mutation in the KISS peptide receptor here. And when we look at that in a mouse model here, those mice also get fat, okay? They're clearly not as obese as those rounded ob mice, so the mice that have the mutation for leptin. But you can see here, they're just kind of pleasantly plump, Okay, so these kisspeptin mutated mice here are also obese. And so work in my laboratory is trying to work out why these guys are obese and how kisspeptin may play a role in regulating obesity. We can see in these mice here, this is like a little mouse X-ray machine that we have, and we can, it's a DEXA scan, and it can actually measure body composition in the mouse, and we can measure specifically their fat mass. And we can see that in these mice here, they have elevated fat mass. One of the really interesting things about these mice here is that they eat less, okay? Whereas the obi-obi mouse, it's under this condition of perceived starvation. It's just got a ravenous appetite. These guys here are eating less. It's almost like they know they're obese, so they're trying to correct their body weight, but despite this sort of reduction in their food intake that they have, they still sort of maintain this plumpness. So it's a really interesting model, and what it tells us is that it's not just obviously food intake that has this importance for your level of obesity, it's also your energy expenditure, okay? And so we can measure energy expenditure. So this is a VO2 max. It's just looking at gas exchange when the animals are breathing, and it sort of measures their metabolic rate. And we can see here that both VO2, and this is their energy expenditure here, there's a lot of squiggly lines on here, but if you kind of blur your eyes, we can see that during the dark phase, and so mice are nocturnal, they do most of their eating and activity at night, you can see the knockouts, which are these black squares here, are always below the wild type or the normal animals here. Okay, so this gives us an indication that these animals have a deficit in energy expenditure. They're not burning energy as fast as a normal animal would. So we think what's happening with this kisspeptin mutation is that there's no real problem with their food intake and the signals in the brain telling them what they should, when they should and shouldn't eat. It's actually they're not able to burn the energy that they are eating with their metabolic rate. And this is my last slide. Just one of the key things that we think is involved here is BAT-UCP1. BAT is brown adipose tissue, okay? It is a special kind of adipose tissue that's metabolically active and it maintains our normal body temperature, okay? And it's one of the key determinants of metabolic rate. And what we see in those animals with the kisspeptin mutation is that they always have reduced UCP1 expression in their BAT. So their BAT is not working properly, okay? It's not driving energy expenditure. It's not driving the metabolism of these mice. So they are becoming obese. And that's pretty much where we sit right now. So just quickly in summary, hopefully I've been able to tell you a few things, but here are just some key take-home messages, I guess. Determinants of appetite, we've got our AGRP, MPY, and our POMC neurons. They're the two main neurons within that arcuate nucleus that are telling you, you need to get some food on board, or you don't really need to eat any food right now, okay? Remembering too that these guys are predominant, they're the bully, okay? So they can silence these guys, but also continue to signal to tell you to keep eating. What happens in the brain when you're hungry? It makes you hangry, okay? MPY, okay? It's signaling to the limbic system and your emotion. It drives you to become hangry. But there's also, as I've mentioned, a lot of other things that are occurring, these deficiencies in growth, effects on the immune system, effects on fertility. Those effects on fertility seem to be affected by our kisspeptin neurons here. So these are those novel neurons here that drive fertility, and they appear to be really well placed to provide a link between reproduction and our metabolism. And then finally, I talked to you a little bit about obesity. And I mentioned it's a big problem, it's getting worse. I think one of the main things we need to do to combat obesity is to provide education about food choices and things like that. But also therapeutics are key, and there is a number of pharmaceutical companies that are looking at leptin, AGRB, POMC, and maybe even kisspeptin as they move forward as potential therapeutics to try and combat obesity. So that's it from me. This is just my last slide here. It's just to indicate to you both a little bit about me, but also the fact that a lot of the work that I showed you here was done by myself, but also through the various laboratories that I've been really lucky enough to work with. So I actually did my undergraduate here at UWA and my PhD here at UWA. After I finished my PhD, I moved to the University of Washington, which is in Seattle, and worked with this group of people here about almost 10 years ago now. I moved from Monash back to Australia. From Washington back to Australia to Monash University in Melbourne and conducted some work with these people here. And now I find myself back at UWA. You can see here I've tried to progressively get back to better and better weather until I got back to Perth, where I'm currently working with these individuals here. So that's it for me. I'll be very happy to take any questions that the two of you may have.
When that says to you, sort of like, don't eat anymore,
yep.
Does that mean that you're full, or it can mean other things as well, right?
Now, generally means it's when you're full.
Oh, okay.
Or if you're in a state where you've got adequate energy stores, okay, and you're not, and there's not an absence of food in the GI tract, then theoretically those POMC neurons will be firing.
Okay.
They're going to make you run around a lot.
So what happens, I'm sure you've heard of the 5 and 2, on those 2 days where you're fasting,
mm-hmm.
and what happens with the production of the leptin then? So you're obviously not going to feed your brain because
yep.
you're only on a certain amount of calories.
Yeah.
Is that a detrimental thing to do that, or is it good? Like, the theory is it's very good for your brain. It
yep.
clears your brain because you're starving it of the food.
Yeah.
But how does that work with the production of leptin? And
I'm thinking when you're hungry, I think your attention is quite elevated. I think the issues of declining cognitive performance only occur after really prolonged levels or prolonged states of undernutrition. Leptin's a funny hormone because it's secreted from your fat, but if you go a few hours without food, probably a bit longer than a few hours, but if you're fasting for, say, half a day, the output of your fat, the amount of leptin it can actually produce is declined as well. So appears to be an overall gauge of how much adiposity you have, but the level of leptin can also increase and decrease depending upon levels of fasting in an individual as well. But in terms of cognitive performance, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't know a lot about that. I know that, the brain requires glucose normally. And so if there's a prolonged period of undernutrition, then I expect that's when you start to see decline in cognitive performance. I get a feeling, though, if you're fasting and, your MPY neurons are firing and they're sort of signalling to other areas of the brain, I think it may even increase cognitive performance in sort of driving your brain, okay, I need to go get some food, and those sorts of things can actually increase cognitive performance. I'm not sure about that, but I think that's what's occurring or what can occur.
Mm. Well, I'd agree because I do follow it, and whenever I have a fasting day,
yep.
everything works a lot better and more clear. I have the best sleep.
Yep.
But then on the days where I'm not fasting and maybe choosing different foods which make you more sluggish, you don't seem to have as much energy.
Yep.
It's just quite interesting. And Dr. Michael Mosley, he just yep. swears by it. But
it's just interesting
how all of these things work.
Yeah, what can also happen after a big meal and something like that, you can have like a rebound effect where your levels of blood glucose can go up enormously, but then you'll secrete a lot of insulin and they will sort of, you'll crash down. The insulin will store all that blood glucose as glycogen, and then once that sort of crashes back down, that's the sort of real sleepy feeling that you can feel sometimes after a big meal. Okay, so it's these fluctuating levels of glucose that can do that. Oh, that's fine. Cool, thank you very much.